but Deuteronomy chapter number 8. I'm reading from verse number 6 to verse number 14, and you will find these following words have been recorded. It says, "So obey the commands of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land of flowing streams and pools of water, with fountains and springs that gush out in the valleys and hills. It is a land of wheat and barley, of grapevines, fig trees, and pomegranates, of olive oil and honey. It is a land where food is plentiful and nothing is lacking. It is a land where iron is as common as stone and copper is abundant in the hills. When you have eaten your fill, be sure to praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you." Verse number 11 says, "But that is the time to be careful. Beware that in your plenty you do not forget the Lord your God and disobey his commands, regulations, and decrees that I am giving you today. For when you have become full and prosperous and have built fine homes to live in, and when your flocks and herds have become very large and your silver and gold have multiplied along with everything else, be careful. Do not become proud at that time and forget the Lord your God, who rescued you from slavery in the land of Egypt." May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy word. This morning, I want to talk about how did I get here. Father God, we come right now just thanking you, O Lord, for this opportunity to just give you praise. It was you who brought us here, woke us up this morning, closed within our right mind. You've given us the activities of our limbs. And we just want to pause for this moment and just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, we just come right now opening up our hearts and our minds to you and just saying, Lord, speak to us. Speak to us. Speak to us, oh Lord. Lord, speak to us. Give us a word today, oh Lord, that will cause us to repent, that will encourage those who need encouragement, oh Lord. And Lord, we just need to hear from you right now. Now, Lord, I just pray right now that you give me a fresh filling of your Holy Spirit, oh Lord. Use me for your glory. And we thank you for what you're getting ready to do in our lives. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Let us all say amen. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise this morning. Come on, put your hands together and give God some praise this morning. Amen. How did I get here? The book of Deuteronomy is written in the form of a treaty between a king and his vassal state. The people he took care of in exchange that all he wants is obedience. It calls Israel to remember who God is and what he has done for them. But lacking faith, the older generation had wandered for 40 years in the wilderness and had died in the wilderness. If they just would have had enough faith, the journey that should have only taken them a couple of weeks took them 40 years. And we find that they left Egypt behind, but they never knew the promised land. On the east bank of the Jordan River, Moses prepared the sons and daughters of the fatherless generation to possess the land. And after a brief history lesson emphasizing God's great acts on behalf of his people, Moses reviewed the law. Then he restated the covenant God's contract with his people. In other words, what Moses was doing in Deuteronomy, he was reminding the people of God of what everything of what God had did for them. And every now and then, you all need a reminder. We need a reminder. Some people may say, well, I need a miracle. No, no, no. You got to understand there's something that goes along with miracles. You see, there are laws. There's the law of gravity that what goes up must come down. There are certain laws that are in the atmosphere, certain laws that are in this physical realm that we must obey. But anytime that you need God to perform a miracle, you are asking God to break one of those or more than one of those laws. Y'all don't hear me in here. And my question is why does God have to always break a law, amen, in order to bail you out of whatever you're going through? Y'all ain't saying nothing. I know there are times that we need miracles, but the thing is what Moses is telling the people of God in Deuteronomy is that here, that you must obey God. Turn to your neighbor and say, you must obey God. Come on now, I want y'all flow with me this morning. You see, the lessons in Deuteronomy are very clear. Because of what God has done, Israel should have hope and follow God because of what he expects. They should listen and obey because of who he is. They should love him completely. Learning these lessons will prepare them to possess the promised land. But see, they could not go into the promised land until they got this word of reminder that God told Moses to give the children of Israel. You see, Moses, the great leader, but before Moses came, Moses is the writer of the first five books of the Bible known as the Pentateuch, you know, and he wrote these books, amen, not only informing, but also to remind us of what God has done. In Genesis, it tells the story of not only the creation, but he also talks about, amen, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons, and one of the sons was named Joseph. Anybody remember Joseph? See, Joseph was that one who was kind of shown favoritism by his mama and his daddy, and that they gave him one of these, I don't know, these electrified coats, amen. He had a coat like no other, and he would walk around and share with his brothers about his dream that he had, and that one day his brother and his family were all going to bow down to him. And the problem was that Joseph wasn't lying, but the thing is that sometimes some folks cannot handle your dream. As true as your dream may be, some folks just can't handle your dream. And when you tell your dream, some folks begin to hate on you. And this is what Joseph's brothers did. They hated on him. And what they did was sold him into slavery. But how many of you know that all things work out for the good of them who love the Lord? What they meant for evil, oh my goodness, God turned it around for his good. Oh my goodness. And see, Joseph, he was sold into slavery. He went to the pits, amen, but then God elevated him to the palace. How many of you know that if you just live right before God, that God will one day lift you up? If you just don't forget where you came from, if you just don't forget who woke you up this morning, who provided everything that you have, that God will just lift you up. Come on, touch your neighbor and say, he will lift you up. So Genesis tells this story, and then Exodus, amen, what it shows is that how the children of Israel exited out of Egypt and were on their way to the promised land. You see, Exodus was from welcome guests to indentured slaves. Y'all don't hear me in here. And see, what's in this thing here is that when Joseph had shared his dream and had performed in such a way that Egypt was blessed because he was in second in command. There was a treaty that, you know, said that, hey, you know, these children of Israel, y'all can hang around here as long as you want. You know, this is my house is your house. And so we can just live together because of what all Joseph did and showing us that we didn't die because of the great famine that took place. But how many, you know, that when someone don't know their history, they will repeat all the mistakes? You see, because in Exodus chapter 1, verse number 8, the Bible says that eventually a new king came in power in Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph or what he had done. You see, before this new king came in place, everything was cool before Israel and Egypt. But then there arose the new king that did not know what Joseph was all about. And he looked out one day and said, you know what? All these Jewish folks out here, they outnumber us. Now, what will happen if they decide that they want to overthrow us? And you see, the problem here is that, you know what, some folks just get a little antsy. They just all of a sudden just get anxiety sets in. They get a little nervous of what could happen, but that was not Israel's intent. They coexisted with Egypt, but this one king says, I don't like how this is flowing. You know what, the devil don't like when folks get along with one another. Y'all don't hear me in here. He don't like when everyone is on the same, is on one accord. But when you start reading in the Bible, is that when people came, become on one accord, when they had one vision, one mind, when they were on the same level, amen, they were able to accomplish many things. But this Pharaoh says, you know what? It's too many of them. We're going to enslave them, and they are going to build everything that we need. So now they turn from welcome guests to now they are slaves. They're making bricks and then bricks without straws. And then God heard the cries of his people. You see, when you go through some things, amen, you can't call to a friend because the friend may be in the same situation that you are in. You don't hear me. I said, when you're going through something, you may not be able to call on a friend because the friend may be going through the same thing that you're going through. You can't call on mama or daddy because their situation could be worse than yours. So who do you call when you're going through something? Somebody say, Jesus. See, when you're going through something, you got to call on the man upstairs. You got to call on the Holy One. You got to call on the one who got the whole world in his hands. So Israel began to call out to God, and God heard their cries. And then God sends Moses, the deliverer, to deliver his people from out of the hands of Pharaoh. And so, you know, he told him that Moses went to him and said, let my people go. God says, let my people go so that they may go into the wilderness and worship me. Well, after all of that exchange that took place, that God had to show Pharaoh that God is God and Pharaoh, you are not God. He took them through a series of things, amen. And at the last one, where the hair that broke the camel's back, God, Pharaoh told Moses, go ahead and take them and get out of my sight. Well, now that they're going and they're leaving, they're exiting out of Egypt, God says, you know what? You've got to learn how to worship me. You've been enslaved under the systems of Egypt for so long, you really don't know how to worship me. So Moses, I need you to pen the book of Leviticus in order that my people may learn how to worship me. Somebody say, worship him, worship him. See, the thing is that you can't have the slave mentality and just worship God any way that you want to worship him. The Bible says that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So that's what the book of Leviticus is about. And then Numbers, amen, comes into play. The book of Numbers, which tells the story of how Israel prepared to enter the promised land, how they sinned and they were punished, and how they prepared to try again. It was a cycle that was with them. And Numbers, the book of Numbers, capture this. And then we have where we're coming from. Our text this morning is Deuteronomy, which reminds the people of what God has done for them and encourages them to rededicate their lives to him. Because I want to let you know, you cannot walk into the blessings of God just any kind of way. Turn to your neighbor and say, you just can't do it any kind of way. No, you can't do it any kind of way. You got to do it God's way. See, we want the blessings of God, but we want to do it our way. But how many of you know that you ain't God? Come on now. You not God. So the thing is that you got to get connected with God, who has all power in his hands, and then say, I'm just going to roll with God. You see, these first five books of the Bible, Moses written them. He wrote them, amen, in order that we may connect with God and see and understand him and worship him. Because when you look at Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 1 through 5, amen, amen, it's on the screen there. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 1, it says, be careful to obey all the commands I am giving you today. Then you will live and multiply, and you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for these 40 years. What was he doing? Why? He was humbling you and testing you to prove your character and to find out whether or not you would obey his commands. Verse 3 says, yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry and then feeding you with what? Manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. He did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone. Has anybody ever read this verse before? And it says, but rather we live by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. And notice in verse 4, this is what I like here. It says, for all these 40 years, in other words, he says, your clothes did not wear out. He says, in all 40 years, you didn't have to go to Macy's. Y'all don't hear me in here. You didn't have to go to Nordstrom's. You didn't have to go to the swap meet. No, he said, for 40 years, your clothes did not wear out. He says, your feet did not blister or swell. Y'all don't hear me. I got a witness here. In other words, God said, it's because of my divine providence that I have taken care of you. You didn't have to go shopping. Amen. Because how many of you been on your feet for so long, amen, and your feet started hurting? Oh my goodness. I want to talk to some folks whose feet hurt every now and then. But God says, I took care of you for 40 years. Didn't need no manicure, didn't need no pedicure, your feet did not swell. He says, none of this happens because I took care of you. And in verse 5, he says, think about it. Just as a parent disciplines a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. My goodness, so God says, you know what, you're gonna enter into the promised land that I promised you, but you just can't just walk in there because the land is occupied. Somebody say, it's occupied. Yeah, somebody's already in there. Amen. They just not going to roll over and give you the land. No. Because they're going to be looking at and say, how'd you get here? Y'all don't hear me in here. Somebody missed that. Yeah. See, God says you're going to cross over and walk into the land, but there are seven nations, or better yet, seven roadblocks to your blessings. Oh, my. Look at Deuteronomy chapter number 7, verse number 1. It says, when the Lord your God brings you into the land you are about to enter and occupy, he says that he will, what, clear, y'all see that right there? He says he will, what, clear away many nations ahead of you. Who are the nations? Who are these seven roadblocks that's in the way of my blessings? Oh my goodness. The Hittites, the Gergesites, and the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, and the Hittites, and the Jebusites. He says these seven nations are greater and more numerous than you. So he said, Israel, don't get it twisted. Don't think you all of that. He says, these folks that are in the land, they're greater than you. They outnumber you. But he says, well, be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Notice what he says in verse number 2. He says, when the Lord your God hands these nations over to you and you conquer them. Y'all didn't catch that. Y'all didn't catch that. He says, when the Lord your God hands these nations over to you and you conquer them. Although they outnumber you. You got these seven roadblocks that's in front of your blessing. But because God has already decreed and declared, he says, no matter how large they are, he says, oh my goodness, that I will hand them over, oh my goodness, to you and conquer them, and you must, what, completely destroy them. Oh, child of God, what's blocking your way to the blessings that God has for your life? But you've been fighting in your own strength. You need to go to God and say, God, you know. God, you know all about it. You know what's standing in front of me. But Lord, I need your help. Is there anybody here that needs the help of the Lord this morning? You trying to get somewhere? You trying to go somewhere? But you got these blessing blockers that in front of you. I didn't say blue blockers, but I said what? Blessing blockers. You got to go to the man upstairs. You got to go to God. You got to go to Jehovah and let him do his thing. He says that I'll hand them over to you and you will conquer them. Because you can't get the blessing until you remove the blessing blockers. You can't get the blessing until you remove the blessing blockers. Y'all ain't catch that. You can't get the blessings until you remove the blessing blockers. Question I gotta ask you is, what's blocking your blessings? What's blocking your blessings? Amen. You got to analyze. You got to look at this thing. You got to see what's standing in the way of your blessings. And it may be other things and circumstances and situations, but it may be you that is the biggest blocker of your blessing. See, we want to beg. We want to blame everybody else. Well, it's because of them. And you know what? If they weren't here and doing this, then I would be able to move a little further. And you know what? If I didn't have this in my life, then you know what? I'll be a few steps further. Anybody ever said that before? You know, if I just would have this and that, if that person went, I wouldn't connect with them, then I would be doing much better. But when are you going to look at the man or the woman in the mirror and say, you are the biggest hindrance. When you gonna keep it real? When you gonna tell the truth? Oh, y'all don't hear me in here. When you gonna speak truth to your own self? Amen. And realize that it may be because of your disobedience that you have been blocking your own blessings. Oh, turn to your neighbor and say, not no more, not no more, not no more, not no more. So he says, these seven nations or these seven roadblocks to your blessing, he said, I'ma handle that. And he says that when you cross over, let me tell you what you're going to have. You have seven fruits or seven blessings that are in the promised land. Notice what he says in our text in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse number 6. He says, obey the commands of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. Could it be that, you know what, because of our disobedience, that we're not getting or receiving the blessings that God has already has for us, but because of our disobedience, amen, we can't put our hands on them? We can see them, but we can't put our hands on them. Y'all don't hear me in here. It says, for the Lord your God, listen, he says, I'm bringing you into a good land. Yeah, not the projects. No, not the hood. Hey, man, no. He says, a good land. Somebody say, good land. Notice what it says. The land is so good, it's flowing with streams of pools and water. Because you know what? I don't care. But you need water to live. Where water flows, food grows. Y'all don't hear me. Amen. You need water. Amen. Not only do you need bread, but you need water. Hello, somebody. It says that you have pools of water with fountains and springs that gush out in the valleys and hills. And he says, you know what? The land is just, it is just so awesome. So awesome. The stuff that you need to survive has already been planted for you. Y'all see that? He says, the people who's occupying the land has already set you up for the blessing that I have in store for you. The people that we gonna run out of the land has already set you up. Oh my goodness. And some of us, we get mad at our enemies, but you got to realize God knows how to use your enemies as your stepping stool. Oh my goodness. So if you got haters, just bless the name of the Lord. That means that you are doing something right. Notice verse number 8. It said, it's the land of wheat. See, the wheat was the best thing, the best grain, amen. It was the best thing. That's where the folks who were rich and who was well-to-do was able to eat the wheat. But then it also say it has a barley also. You see, barley is not as good as wheat, but you can still eat it. So you feed barley to horses, and you can still make barley cakes and all of that kind of stuff. You can still do some things with barley. Amen. You got to remember the little boy who gave up his lunch in order for Jesus to feed 5,000 plus folks, you know, with the fish and the bread. What the bread that the boy had was barley bread. See, the barley bread was for low income folks. Y'all don't hear me in here. Folks who didn't have enough money to have wheat, but they still needed bread. And God took what was considered to be the least, amen, to consider to be that of the lowest. And God says that, hey, he broke it and he multiplied it and he fed 5,000, that there were still 12 baskets of bread and fish left over. I come to let you know that little becomes much when you put it in the master's hands. I want to talk to some folks that took the little bit that they had and put it in the master's hand, and God multiplied it. Although I got a witness in here. You put it in the master's hand and he turned that thing around. He multiplied and you looking at the situation and saying, how did I get here? What is he said, the land is it has wheat, barley of grapevines and fig trees and pomegranates and olive oil and honey. He says, this land has everything you need. I see, the thing is that he says, it's a land where food is plentiful and nothing is lacking. Isn't that what he says? He says, it's a land where iron is there. Amen. That copper is there. Now, God says, now, you know what? You, I delivered you from Egypt. You didn't have nothing there. Nothing. You lacked there. I brought you into the wilderness. For 40 years, I took care of you. And in the wilderness, you had just enough. Somebody say just enough. Yeah. But he says, where I'm taking you is to a into prosperity, to where you will have more than enough. I got a few to hear that just caught that. Amen. Somebody ain't caught it. It's like, what you clapping for? But tell him, Pastor coming around one more time. He coming around one more time. See, the thing is God said, you know, the reason you got to remember is because if you get to the prosperity, you will think that you got there. But you got to remember your Egypt days when you had nothing. And he says, then you got to remember your wilderness days when you only had just enough. But God says, I'm about to move you into prosperity where you have more than enough. Come on now, y'all. Come on now. Somebody hear me here. And see, the thing is that God wants to bless you. But in order to bless you, he just wants you to remember him. And just worship him. Touch your neighbor and say, he just wants you to worship him. Well, where you see that at, Pastor? Look in verse number 10. Verse number 10, bring up verse number 10. He says, now, when you have eaten your fill. When you have eaten your fill. And ain't no fun unless the homies. Can have some. God says, you know what? It's going to be so much that not only you can have some, but you're going to have some overflow. Somebody say, I'm looking for the overflow. But he says the prerequisite to this, how you keep this going, he says that when you have eaten your fill, he says, be sure. You see, from this verse, this is where we get to where we bless our food before we eat it. Y'all don't hear me in here. Y'all don't bless your food before you eat it. Amen. Maybe you started out with God is great. God is good. Let us thank you for this food. Amen. Maybe you started out like that, praying that prayer. But in some shape, form, and fashion, as a believer, you ought to give God thanks for everything that you have. He says, when you have eaten your fill, he says, be sure to do what? To praise the Lord. Do y'all see that? He said, be sure to do what? To praise the Lord. For what? The Lord your God, for the good land he has given you. Oh my goodness. What has God done for you? Have you praised God for it? Have you taken enough time to say, thank you, Lord, for all of what you have done for me? Have you taken the time to just say, Lord, I thank you. All praise is due unto you, O God. And see, the thing is that you got to realize if you won't learn to praise him, God will take you back to lack. Just in order for you to remember what you used to have. He'll take you back from prosperity to lack because why? You forgot to praise God. Oh my goodness. I'm trying to help somebody in here. See, in the process, there was lack. In the progress, there was just enough. But in prosperity, you're going to have what? More than enough. But when you're in more than enough, and you forget to praise God, God will take you all the way back to the process, which is lack. Y'all not connecting yet. He'll take you all the way back to lack. And to the point you say, oh God, you know what I need. And then after you now, you want to come to church and you want to obey God. Then God say, okay, let's graduate you to just enough. Y'all don't hear me in here. And then when you're getting just enough, God says, you've been there long enough. Now it's time for me to promote you into more than enough. But then if you don't act right, and if you don't praise God, God says, you know what? You got to repeat the cycle. You didn't flunk the test. I got to take you all the way back over here and lack. Oh, y'all don't hear me in here. Some people, you still ain't got it. See, when in lack, you needed a car. Oh Lord God, I got this job. I got to get around. I get to ride. This bus ain't running on time and all this kind of stuff. So God said, okay, in your lack, I see you need a car. But then he takes you, oh my goodness, to just enough. You got a hoopty. Y'all don't hear me in here. You got a hoopty now. Now you ain't on the bus stop. You like me. That used to be me. But God blessed you. Then now you got a hoopty. But you took care of the hoopty. You washed the hoopty. Amen. You cleaned the hoopty. And God says, you know what? Now let's get you from the hoopty to now you in your Mercedes Benz, your BMW. Now you in prosperity. But now you in prosperity and you talking about look at me and how I'm riding and all this kind of stuff. Now your car can't come to the church no more. It don't even know the direction. So God says, okay, you got to repeat the process. Y'all don't hear me in here. I got to take you back to lack. Because it seemed like in your lack, you gave me praise. In lack, you had no job. But then you started praying, oh God, give me a job. So he puts you in progress or just enough. He gave you a temporary job. And then you came to work on time, but you was before time. You did work before you clocked in because you wanted to show everybody you was a good employee. So God says, oh, your intentions are right. Your motives are right. So God says, we're going to take you from permanent and give you a promotion to now you got more than enough. Now you on permanent. Now you showing up late for the job. Y'all don't hear me. You don't care about the job no more. You're taking extended lunches. And God said, you won't even give me praise for the job and the promotion that I gave you. I got to take you back to lack. Oh, my goodness. There's somebody here say, oh, Lord, I'm tired of being alone. I don't want to be single no more. Oh, give me a man. Give me a woman. Oh, Lord, I'm tired of being single. So you know what? That was your lack. Oh, my goodness. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. In your lack, you had bad credit. But then in your just enough, God gave somebody who was crazy enough to co-sign for you. But now in your prosperity, you got good credit. So now you say, look what I did. Look what I built. Look what I got. And God said, you must have forgot. You got to repeat the cycle all over again. Oh, child of God, what I'm trying to get you to understand is that no matter what space that you are in, if you are in lack, you got to learn how to praise God. Amen. If you're in the land of just enough, you got to give God the praise. Amen. If you're in the area of more than enough, The Lord says that he don't want you to forget about him. Because he says in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse number 11, he says there is a warning about prosperity. You see, because there comes a problem that when you begin to get more than enough, that you tend to forget all about God. He says, but that is the time to be careful. And he says, beware that in your plenty, you do not forget the Lord your God and disobey his commands, his regulations and decrees. For he says, for when you have become full and prosperous and have built your fine homes that you're living in now, he says, and when your flocks and herds have become very large and your silver and gold has multiplied, he says, along with everything else, he says, be careful. Come on, turn to your neighbor and say, be careful. He says, don't become proud at that time and forget the Lord your God who rescued you from slavery in the land of Egypt. See, the thing is, you don't want to go and repeat the cycle. Amen. But when God brings you into prosperity, you want to learn how to stay right there. I'll turn to your neighbor and say, learn how to stay right there. See, how do I stay in prosperity? How do I break the cycle of the sin and me having to go from lack, amen, to just enough, then just enough to more enough, and then go back to lack? What the Bible says in Deuteronomy verse 8, chapter 8, verse 10, he says, you got to learn to give God the praise. He says, when you're eating your fill, when you come full of everything that I blessed you with, God says, you got to praise me no matter what. So the point that I want to give you today is to give God the praise. Give God praise no matter what. See, the thing is, if you want to stay in prosperity, you got to say, I didn't do it, but God did it for me. Is there anybody here who can truly stand up and say, I didn't pull myself up by my own bootstraps, but when I look back over my life and I ask myself a question of how did I get here, I can truly say it's nothing but by the grace of God. Is there anybody here who can look back over their life and say, I'm in the land of prosperity, but I'm here by the grace of God, and because God has been good to me, I've got enough sense to every now and then to take a moment out of my time to give God, to give him some praise. Is there anybody here who can give God some praise for all of the things that he's done for you? Look back over your life. Some of us was in hoopties, but look at me now. He's blessed me that I'm driving not just on a car that I need, but he gave me the car that I want, and it's nothing but by the grace of God. God did it, then he do it. God did it. Is there anybody here that knows that it was nothing but the hand of God that has been on your life? Your enemies are hating you, and they are wondering, how did you get here? Just say it's only by the hand of God. I was never smart enough, didn't have enough money, but God never knew the right people. But God was born on the wrong sides of the track. But God was in the wrong neighborhood. But God, you may have a family record, but God, you may have grown up with lack on in your house. But God, God, I'm going to praise you, because I realize you are truly, truly a word of Psalms 23:1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Does anybody know him as the good shepherd that you shall not want? Won't he bless you? Won't he bless you? Put you in houses that you did not build. Put you in cars that you may not be the first owner of that car. But you can look back and say it was the hand of God. So that's why I get up early in the morning. I come to the house of the Lord. I come before anybody else comes to serve in the house of the Lord. I come lifting up holy hands to give God praise and thanks. Is there anybody here that can praise him? Who's done in your life? Has God done anything for you? Put your hands together and give God the praise. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You God for me, and I just thank him for what I have. He'll bless me with even more. If you ain't got much, thank him for what you have. God, all that I have, give it back to you. God will multiply. Won't he do it? Yes! How did I get here? It's nothing but by the grace of God. How did I get here? It's by his goodness and his mercy. He promised me it shall follow me all the days of my life. Dwell in the house of the Lord. Say yes, say yes, 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 yes. Maybe you need to take that baby. Give me a little room. Give me a little room. Give me a little room. I'ma praise him. Give me a little room. Cause when I look back over my life and see how God has blessed me, my soul get happy. My soul gets happy. I give God all the praise. Yeah, 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 yeah. How you get here? How'd you get here? Lord done blessed you with a business. Oh my goodness. How'd you get here? Oh my goodness. What's God doing in your life? How'd you get here? Oh my goodness. Sean came through the doors this morning with a smile on her face and said, You know what? I don't have no job no more. Amen. But I'm stepping out on faith and starting my own business. Oh my goodness. God's going to multiply. God's going to lift you up. God's going to bless you. And in spite of, amen, what situations look like, you just keep on lifting. You just keep on lifting him up. Just keep on lifting him up. No matter what your situation look like, you ought to praise him for what your future is going to look like. Don't give him a lack praise. No, don't give him a just enough praise, but give him a praise, a prosperity. God wants you to open up his mouth and just bless him, bless him, bless him, bless him, bless him, bless him. And when he open up the windows of heaven and pour you out, just pour you out a window. Blessing that you won't even have room enough to receive it. Somebody say that's overflow. I'm tired of living in lack. I'm tired of living in just enough. But come on now, somebody say I want overflow. Come on now, you tired of just enough, amen. You want to go from a one truck carpet cleaner to where you have your fleet, amen. That's more than enough. Y'all don't hear me in here. You just don't want to be barely making it. How you doing? Well, I'm making it. I'm struggling. No. God wants us to live an abundant life, amen. I want to live in the land of just enough. And as overflow comes on my life, amen. That means I can bless somebody else. That means I can bless somebody else. That means I can bless somebody else. When overflow was coming in my life, that means if I give you something, I'm not gonna miss nothing because it's overflow. Somebody shout overflow. Somebody shout overflow. Anybody want overflow in their life? Say, Lord, give me overflow. Lord, give me overflow. I want overflow.